This is the final session in our wonderful evidence-based practice MOOC. We hope that you really have learned from the content that we have been providing you. And most importantly, we hope that you will take the content and actually move it into the real world to make a difference. So this last session is really focused on how to make this happen, evidence-based practice in your organization, and how to sustain it. So oftentimes an organization will get this moving, but then it dwindles. We want to share with you our golden nuggets for how not only to implement this to make it happen, but also to sustain it in your organization. Our dream is that by 2020, evidence-based practice will be in the DNA of every practicing clinician throughout the world. Well, evidence-based practice also needs to be in the DNA of every organization. The whole culture, the environment has to be one of evidence-based practice if clinicians are going to be successful in consistently implementing this with their patients. Now, I'd like to remind you that change is what I call character building. It doesn't happen easily. So for those of you out there who have a high D personality like me, which is a dreamer, a driver, a risk taker, discoverer, we like to dream big and run very quickly. Patience is not our biggest virtue. So as you can see on the slide, I do make a joke of this and saying that the only people who really like change are babies with wet diapers. But in all seriousness, the majority of people do not like change. They fear change. What is this change going to mean for me? For my organization. And we have to remember, people who resist change often have fear. Fear of something. How is that change going to impact them? So many times when you encounter a resistive person, sitting down with them saying, I can see that you are fearing this particular change. Talk to me about that. Sometimes just that conversation can help move them along for change. So we need a big dream. We have to get the team to buy into the dream. And remember, stories are very powerful in getting people to change by raising their emotions. So you got to have that team dream. But you also have to embed EBP in the philosophy, in the vision, in the mission of the organization. The more places you can embed EBP and the expectation for people to function in that way, the better. This needs to be in orientation sessions. When you do bring in new employees into the institution. If you have a clinical ladder system, this needs to be embedded into the clinical ladder as well into performance expectations and evaluations. The whole organization needs to embrace a spirit of inquiry where questions are welcome. Not frowned upon. I get so excited to work with bedside clinicians who have this spirit of inquiry that's always questioning, what's the best evidence behind what am I doing? Or is this something that's based in a steep tradition? That's the way we've always done it. And one of the easiest ways to create a spirit of inquiry is to make Pico boxes. And you can dress them up any way you want to, but put a Pico box in every patient area. And then you can put a poster up that says, "Got Pico," and explains that. You know, get your people to start writing down their clinical questions in PICO format, and then help them to search for the best evidence, to critically appraise that evidence, synthesize it, and decide whether a practice change should be made. The other key strategy that's in our ARC model that I showed you in the first session is that of evidence-based practice mentors. Through our research, we have shown a critical mass of evidence-based practice mentors is absolutely essential, because those people need to take clinicians who are at point of care, and they need to help them, mentor them consistently to deliver evidence-based care. Administrative role modeling and support is also a key element for sustaining cultures of EBP. Leaders and managers must walk the talk. If we as leaders aren't walking the talk, we aren't going to stand a chance of our clinicians following us and listening to us when we tell them we want you to implement evidence-based care. The infrastructure has to be there. People need the tools and resources to implement and sustain EBP. Lastly, there has got to be recognition built into your system. I always say, when I can't pay people more money, recognition becomes even more important. We need to show our people that we value them and we appreciate them. A little handwritten note once in a while, an email that says, "Thank you, I really appreciate what you're doing in helping us advance evidence-based practice," goes a very long way. And then, as I talked about in my first lecture, we need to integrate the new research-based, evidence-based practice competencies in everything that we do. So if you have not yet downloaded these competencies from the journal Worldviews on Evidence-Based Nursing, I'd really encourage you to do that and look at those competencies and try and assess in your organization, where can you embed these? Can you introduce them to people in your orientation sessions? Can you build them into your clinical ladder? Can you build them into your performance evaluations? I showed you our evidence-based practice model in the first session, but we now have multiple studies to support that implementation of a critical mass of evidence-based practice throughout a system really improves so what outcomes in your system and helps you to sustain evidence-based practice. I want you to remember, education alone isn't going to be enough to sustain evidence-based practice. Yes, clinicians need the knowledge and the skills. They have to practice those skills. Habits, again, are not easy to change or to create. So practicing this on a consistent basis will definitely be needed to sustain it, as well as creating cultures and environments where evidence-based practice can not only survive, but thrive is super important. Lastly, I want you to remember, when you're walking into a unit or an organization and you want to implement any change, I always look for the people with a twinkle in their eye and a fire in their belly. And those are the folks I start to work with first. And of course, those people are known as innovators and early adopters. Please do not put your valuable time into working with the laggards. Once you get enough innovators and early adopters on board, you're going to get the early majority. And at that point, the culture's going to shift. It is not bad if laggards cannot join in the effort of what you're doing, if they decide it's not a good fit and they leave. Because a few laggards truly can be like a cancer in your organization and slow the momentum and energy down. So to end, don't forget, dream big. Get your team excited. Get a common purpose for why you want to improve quality and safety and patient outcomes through evidence-based practice. Believe and support your team to accomplish that vision. Persist through the character builders. Cultures take, at the very least, 3 to 5 years to really change. So if you're a high D, I urge you to become a little more patient and just don't give up. Change takes a lot of time, but find your early adopters and your innovators and get them excited. Be excited. You know, people love to be around other people who are enthusiastic. We have way too much stress today. We have way too many people walking around kind of in a coma of complacency. We got to get dreams built back in people again. We got to get them excited about where they're going and the impact they can make. We need to persist through those character builders. I am biased because I'm the editor of this wonderful journal, Worldviews, on evidence-based nursing, and my terrific colleague, Lynn Gallagher Ford, edits a new column called Implementing and Sustaining EBP in Real-World Practice Settings. We're the number 3rd ranked journal now in nursing in the world, which is terrific, but I really, in editing this journal, I try to make the articles applicable to real-world clinical practice settings. And if any, in every article, we have a box, and it's called Linking Evidence to Action. So we help people think through what they should be doing in clinical care based on the evidence in that article. Our American Journal of Nursing series takes you through each step of EBP using a real-world clinical situation. So I encourage you to check that out. Lastly, remember to be an EBP mentor, implementer. We have to eliminate this saying from our vocabulary, because we've always done it that way. So instead of taking one bite out of a time out of a 2-ton chocolate elephant, I have a healthier version now for you. Remember to keep dreaming big, believe in those dreams, risk take, and persist through the character builders until EBP is in both your organizational DNA and in the DNA of every single clinician.